Assalamu alaikum viewers, I'm Professor Dr. Mohammad Asghar from Fauji Foundation Hospital. Our today's lecture will be hemorrhage. We will be discussing the detail about type of hemorrhage and their management. So let's start with what will be our aim of today's lecture. My first slide is about the main objective that we will be having. It will be discussing the definition, the pathophysiology, what will be the pathophysiology of various type of hemorrhages, type and causes of hemorrhage, degree of classification, how do you classify, then what will be the signs and symptoms, what are the effects of hemorrhage on the body, and the control of external bleeding, how do you control first aid treatment of external bleeding. Then how do you try to control the internal bleeding, first aid treatment of internal bleeding, nursing care, and in the last we'll deal with the summary. So what is the definition of hemorrhage? Hemorrhage means escape of blood outside its containing vessel, or you can summarize it like that. Hemorrhage means the loss of blood from the vascular system associated with an absolute reduction in the circulating blood volume, or it may be defined as loss of blood from body as a result of injury or illness. So what are the causes of hemorrhage? Simple causes as we encounter in daily life, such as wounds, incised wound, laceration, abrasion, contusion, puncture wound, gunshot wound, fracture of large bones, intraoperative bleeding, road traffic accidents resulting in multiple trauma, blunt trauma injury to liver, spleen, mesentery. Invasive diagnostic procedure may lead into hemorrhage. Anatomical defects, canine bite, crush injury, and varicose bleeding, as such as varices, nosophageal varices. So, what are the pathophysiology of hemorrhage? Bleeding results in hyperbilirubinemia. Hyperbilirubinemia lead to hyperperfusion of the tissues. There is a cellular and aerobic metabolism and lactic acidosis that result in decreased coagulant proteases leading to coagulopathy and further hemorrhage. The ischemia of the cell and anticoagulation pathway is activated. Tissue perfusion is decreased, blood pressure is decreased, and the blood supply to gut and muscles is decreased. This is the early compensation that the body does. If the hemorrhage continues or the perfusion of the muscles remain underperfused, unable to generate heat, then there may be hypothermia, coagulation becomes more poor, temperature decreases, leading into further hemorrhage, hypoperfusion, and acidosis. And if not treated, will lead to death finally. And what is the classification of hemorrhage? According to WHO, grade 0 is no bleeding, whereas grade 1 is petechial hemorrhage is bleeding, grade 2 is mild blood loss, clinically significant, grade 3 is gross blood loss, requires transfusion, and grade 4 is debilitating blood retinal or cerebral associated with fatality. So what is advanced trauma life support classification? Class 1 is hemorrhage involves up to 15% of the blood volume. Class 2 hemorrhage involves about 15 to 30% of the total blood volume. And class 3 hemorrhage involves about loss of 30 to 40% of the circulating blood volume. Whereas class 4 hemorrhage involves loss of more than 40% of the circulating blood volume. What are the types of hemorrhages? Depending on the nature of the blood vessel involved, depending on the timings of the hemorrhage, depending on the duration of the hemorrhage, depending on the nature of bleeding, depending on the type of intervention. Nature of vessels. If it is an arterial source, the bleeding will be bright red, emitted as spurting jet, can lead to severe blood loss, often hard to control. And if there is a venous blood loss, the blood is much darker in color, it is steady and copious flow, color becomes further darker with oxygen desaturation, and there is usually easy to control by simple pressure. If the bleeding source is capillary and it is bright red, rapid and oozing, blood loss becomes serious if continuous for hours, generally minor and easy to control. Timing of hemorrhage. It can be classified as primary hemorrhage occurred at the time of surgery, causes injury to the blood vessels, maybe arterial, venous or capillary, more common in surgery or malignancy. Then there may be a reactionary hemorrhage, bleeding within 24 hours, especially after 4 to 6 hours of surgery. Causes slipping of ligature, dislodgement of the clot or cessation of the reflex vasospasm. Bleeding will start when there is a rise in arterial or venous pressure. Then there is a secondary hemorrhage, occurred after 7 to 14 days of surgery, causes clotting of the vessel due to infection, pressure necrosis or malignancy. The first warning stain followed by sudden severe bleeding. Common after hemorrhoid surgery, GI surgery and amputations. Then I have a classification according to the duration of the hemorrhage. Acute hemorrhage occurs suddenly, that is esophageal variceal bleeding due to portal hypertension. Then chronic hemorrhage, it occurs slowly and steadily over a passage of time, which begins several days a week after bleeding initially starts, that is subdural hematoma, chronic peptic ulcer, hemorrhoids, etc. Then what nature of the hemorrhage? External hemorrhage or real hemorrhage? External hemorrhage or visible bleed, soft tissue injury, bleeding from limbs, wound, nose. Then there is another type of hemorrhage that is known as concealed hemorrhage or internal hemorrhage. It is not visible to the naked eye. It may be due to blood or penetrating trauma to the abdomen or to the chest, may remain concealed as in ruptured spleen or liver or intra-chest bleeding, hemoperitoneum or hemothorax. Concealed hemorrhage may become revealed as in hematemesis or malignant peptic ulcer bleed. Then type of intervention that we have to do with hemorrhages. Surgical hemorrhages are the result of injury amenable to surgical control or from angioembolism. This is an invasive radiological procedure, how we control blood vessels without operating upon them. Then there are non-surgical hemorrhage. General use from all loss of due to coagulopathy can not be stopped by surgical means. Required correction of coagulation abnormalities. Then what are the signs and symptoms of hemorrhage? The early signs are patient become restlessness, there is anxiety, feeling of faint or losing consciousness, cold, clammy skin or periphery temperature slightly abnormal due to vasoconstriction. There is a dryness of face, dry mouth, loose skin appearance due to contraction of erected pylorum. Patient feel thirsty. Then what are the signs and symptoms after severe hemorrhage? There will be extreme pallor, air hunger, rapid threading pulse, extreme low blood pressure, extreme thirst, diminished urine output, blindness, tinnitus and coma occur prior to death. What are the effects of hemorrhage on the body? On the cardiovascular system, there is a reduced blood after hemorrhage, decreased venous return, ventricular filling and cardiac output. Then decreased mild hemorrhage when there is a loss of small amount of blood up to 350 to 500 ml, the blood pressure decreases slightly and soon it returns back to normal due to the compensatory mechanism in already functioning in the body. Then during severe hemorrhage, when hemorrhage is severe with loss of about 1.5 liter to 2 liter of blood, arterial blood pressure falls to a greater extent. The normal cutoff values are 90 by 60. Below that, any blood pressure is considered as low. Then what will happen to the skin? There will be vasoconstriction in the blood vessel. It increases the deoxygenation of the blood. It results in pallor, sometimes cyanosis develop. On tissue fluid, arteriole constrict, decreasing the capillary pressure. It helps to compensate the blood loss. On kidney, constriction of afferent efferent arterioles of kidney after hemorrhage decreases the GFR, therefore the urinary output decreases. On renin secretion, hypoxia produces after blood loss increases secretion of renin from kidney and subsequent formation of angiotensin II. It also increases release of aldosterone from adrenal cortex. Aldosterone causes retention and sodium, retention of fluid and sodium. On secretion of antidiuretic hormone, ADH release in large quantity immediately after hemorrhage, which is probably due to increase of molarity of body fluid by aldosterone induced sodium retention. Effects on respiration include hemorrhage, causes stagnant hypoxia because of decrease in venous return and cardiac output. Effects on nervous system, reticular formation, the catecholamine stimulates the reticular activating system, it causes restlessness, anxiety, and increased motor activity after hemorrhage. On brain, though hemorrhage causes vasoconstriction in many organs, it usually causes vasodilatation in brain. There may be fainting when hemorrhage is severe, cardiac output decreases and blood pressure falls, so the blood flow to the brain decreases, resulting in unconsciousness. Cerebral ischemia, when the blood flow to the brain is severely affected due to hypoxia, ischemia of the brain tissue develops within 5 minutes, it causes irreversible damage to the brain tissue. Control of external hemorrhage. We can use pads and bandages. This is a simple method of applying direct pressure to a bleeding wound and is applicable to vast majority of cases. It is effective and causes no damage. Collateral damage is minimal. Digital pressure may be applied. It is a pressure applied on the point of artery supplying the blood to the area of wound. This will control hemorrhage temporarily and is called direct indirect pressure. Elevation of the limb. It will control venous hemorrhage. This is a classical method of dealing with a sudden hemorrhage from a ruptured varicose vein of leg. Here gravity acts as to control the hemorrhage. Application of tunic. A temporary tunic may have to be devised in sudden emergency. It should be 3 to 4 inches wide. The greater danger of tunic is that if it's kept for more than maximum time of 90 to 180 minutes, it may result in ischemia of the limb. Then there is a surgical ligation. It is necessary if bleeding is persistent. Coagulation may be used to coagulate the blood from small blood vessel. Then packing can be done. It may act as a temporarily control severe hemorrhage. This method is used in the patient data to control temporary and sudden hemorrhage. And when the packs are removed, there is a clot formation by the internal mechanism of coagulation and resultant sealing of the blood vessel. First aid treatment in case of severe external hemorrhage. Bring the side of the wound together and press firmly if there is a wound externally. Press on the pressure point for 10 to 15 minutes. Place the casualty in comfortable position and raise the injured part and reassure him. Here, due to gravity, the blood flow to the limb or the part will decrease and the bleeding will also decrease. Apply a clean pad larger than the wound and press it firmly with palm until bleeding becomes less. If bleeding continues, do not take off original dressing but add more pads. Bandage is but not too tightly. How to control internal hemorrhage? The organ is emptied of blood clots if possible in case of severe hemorrhage from bladder, a catheter is placed and bladder is emptied. The vessels are encouraged to contract a lot of saline and sodium bicarbonate to which a few drops of adrenaline solution has been added. It is great value in washing the organ. This can be repeated after every 2 hours. The use of oxytocin after birth of placenta is an example of stimulating the vessel to contract. Vasopressin may be effective in control of bleeding from esophageal ascites. Packing can be done with gauze soaked in adrenaline is effective. Surgical ligation can be done in case of ruptured spleen. What will be the first aid treatment in the case of severe internal bleeding? Lay the casualty down with head low, raise his leg with pillows beneath them, keep them calm, relaxed, and reassure him. Don't allow him to move. Keep up the body heat, thin blanket and coats. Do not give anything to eat or drink. Aspiration can occur. Do not apply ice bag or hot water bag to chest or abdomen. Use modified Trendelenburg position for patient to increase cardiac output. take him to the hospital as soon as possible, transport urgently. Nursing management. Frequent assessment is very important. Documents the progress and response of the patient. Assess blood chemistries, blood gas, blood saturation, and electrolytes. Assess for airway bleeding and circulation. Identify the bleeding site, amount of blood loss, as nature of injury. Assess respiratory rate for the clearance, rate of respiration and auscultation of the respiratory sound for any abnormality. Note risk for infection related to bleeding. Note risk for shock, hypovolemia related to bleeding. What will be our aims of whenever there is a significant hemorrhage? Our aim will be to improve oxygenation of the body tissue, restore and maintain adequate perfusion of the tissues, temperature monitoring, cardiac monitoring, bleeding control, assess for fluid overload, assess for fluid overload, psychological support to patient and family, nutrition and blood transfusion if required. Transfusion massive hemorrhages, if the patient anemic and hemodynamically stable, we go for an ideal HP of 9 mg/L. It should be, if the HP is more than that, we don't require any transfusion. And if it is below 9, does the patient have acute coronary syndrome or severe sepsis or neurological injury? If no, then use the default HP trigger of 7 with a target of 7 to 9. And if there is severe sepsis, then early 6 hours from the onset, target should be 9 to 10 gram per liter. If the evidence of tissue hypoxia, then later than more than 6 hours from onset, the target HP should be more than 7 milligram per liter. In neurocritical care, we should have a target of 9 gram. In subarachnoid hemorrhage, target should be 8 to 10 gram. In ischemic heart disease, target should be 8 to 9 gram. In a patient with stable angina, target should be more than 7 gram per milliliter. This is a chart showing the transfusion and management of massive hemorrhage. I think you can copy this chart and view in detail after, because it's written very small here. I may not be able to explain all. Activate massive hemorrhagic pathway, resuscitation, airway breathing, circulation, prevent hypothermia. Aim for therapy, HP should be maintained at 8 to 10 gram per deciliter. Platelets. Call for help, blood, and send for lab, testing of the blood, order of the blood. For every 4 units of blood, 4 FFP should be arranged. And control the bleeding, hemostatic drugs, hemorrhage control, and finally surgery. So here we come to the end of the type of hemorrhages, how they are caused, how they are classified, and how do we do an emergency treatment, what are the reasons for giving blood transfusions. We won't be discussing the complication with blood transfusion. If you still have any queries, you can still email me and I would like to answer you. Thank you very much. That is all for today. Till we meet for the next lecture. Thank you very much.